We have four people that understand something about consensus. They have projects. They're going to come to the stage and tell us about this. Okay. So please welcome to the stage Roman Oliynykov from IOHK Cardano, Valery from Golos, Trent from Big Chain DB, and Maxim Orlovsky from Pandora Blockchain. So please introduce you yourself, like in let's say in one paragraph, what is your project, and like about yourself, your role in the project, and what's your project trying to solve. So Maxim, Roman, you will start. You are from IOHK Cardano, right?
I'm from IHK Cardano. I'm a team leader of the Veritas team, which works within R&D group at IHK. We are working on scaling consensus scaling algorithm on treasury and on other research topics. Besides it, I am a professor at Karazin National University in Kharkov. Also give lectures in other universities from time to time. I'm invited to some other universities in Ukraine and abroad.
Yeah. Cool. Okay, Valery, you are next. You Valery Litvin, you are from Cyber Fund, and the project you are going to represent is Golos. So tell us a little bit about it.
Hello, everyone. My name is Valery Litvin, and I am a CTO of Cyber Fund. I'm absolutely sure that part of you familiar with our projects. It's a Cyber Fund, Satoshi Fund, Golos, social media, blockchain network, which we launched in the October of 16. And I am very happy and motivated that here in BIP, in Kyiv, we can discuss consensus algorithms, because it's the main field, main point in whole blockchain industry.
Cool. Okay, so next one is Trent, and he will represent Big Chain DB.
Hi there, yes. I'm Trent McConaghy, and I'm with Big Chain DB, the company. And we're shipping a product called BigchainDB software, which is a scalable blockchain database. So it's designed to bring in scale from the distributed database world, the likes of MongoDB, with benefits of blockchain, decentralized immutable assets. So that's what BigchainDB is about. It's been an open source project for more than 2 years. And we're also spending time on a new protocol called Ocean Protocol. For this conversation, we'll be focusing on BigchainDB though.
Okay, cool. Last but not least, Maxim Orlovsky, tell us about the Pandora blockchain. What are you solving?
Yeah, my path with the crypto started in 2014 with Bitcoin Foundation Ukraine, together with Mike Chabanian and other guys. And these days we are doing a Pandora blockchain, which is in fact a sort of maybe Skynet. We already talked about that. I have some news that it wouldn't be an enterprise. It would be decentralized, so unstoppable. My role in this project is that I'm trying to be no one, because it is a protocol, and the protocol have no people with the roles. It's just a protocol.
Okay, cool. So here's the plan, guys. I want to make we have 40 minutes for this, 4-0, right? 40 minutes for the panel. Let's make 20 minutes of structured discussion and introduction of the project and consensus. And I want to ask you in audience to put down questions about consensus algorithms. And we are going to have 20 minutes of Q&A. And I think we have a very nice panel of specialists. So think about questions, algorithmic questions, mathematical questions to trying to attack algorithms and say, okay, I don't like proof of work, I like proof of stake or something like this. And this will be the second part of the panel. Okay, so let's start with the first one, and let's give our speakers opportunity to actually explain more about their project. So first question, let's do it like this, 4 minutes for each of you. Because we are focusing on consensus, so please, say and introduce consensus algorithm in your project, why it was chosen, what was the questions and pros and cons that you consider while choosing this algorithm. Okay, and let's try to focus on this and not all about all the projects. No, I see. Okay, Roman, you will start, please. Cardano project,
Okay, thank you. We started developing a consensus protocol for Cardano in 2016. And we decided from the first days of it to use proof of stake approach. Why have we chosen proof of stake? There are rather many disadvantages of proof of work. If we look to current statistics of Bitcoin, we will see that we have a huge energy consumption. We will have a high cost of running this protocol. So if we look, for energy consumption, you must have heard about gigawatts of energy. For cost per one transaction, it's from different sources, beginning from very reliable Ukrainian specialist till citation of Vitalik Buterin from Ethereum. One transaction can energy for one transaction at proof of work of nowadays Bitcoin can cost from 5 kilowatts till 200 kilowatts. So huge energy consumption. We spend energy for nothing, just for destroying our planet. If we omit these arguments, if we return only to economic incentives, then we can look for statistics from, for example, blockchain info, and cost of one transaction is more than $100. As a couple of days ago, I checked it was approximately $110 the cost for one transaction. Most of these coins goes through newly minted cost goes through newly minted coins. So it means we heavily depends of newcomers who buy new bitcoins, and all this a significant part of this cost goes to spend electricity to produce mining equipment and so on and so on. And if we remove we can also see difference between the ratio for transaction fee in that part, it will be approximately 10% for transaction fee and 90% for newly minted coins. So if for some reason we just stop mint these new coins, in this case we will have only $10 which we currently get from transaction fees, so 90% will be gone. And from security point of view, it can be rather dangerous because not all miners will be happy with it. Network miners will start to leave network, and in this case not significant part of nowadays existing computing power can be used to attack network, to do double spend attack and so on. It doesn't mean that we have security problems with nowadays Bitcoin, but it means that we don't have equilibrium situation in today.
One more minute.
Oh, I'm sorry. it means that in future we must change to another solution. For this case, we developed Ouroboros. It's pure proof of stake protocol. It's the first probably secure protocol. We use a very strict theoretical model. We use very realistic assumptions. The protocol is simple, and to get the equal security guarantees that we already have for Bitcoin now, we don't need huge computational power. To issue a block, it's enough to have computational power, which we have in our smartphones. That's okay. We don't waste energy, and we produce blocks. We provide the same level of security guarantee. It's the first level which is run right now in Cardano, and besides it, we have other scaling properties, properties that additionally increase the security of our protocol.
Okay.
And
you want to wrap it up in one sentence?
Okay, so we continue to develop. Now we have Ouroboros Classic, which is run in Cardano, and we already have next version, which is Ouroboros Browse, that provides additional security guarantees, and we have another solutions for scaling it in Cardano.
Okay, awesome introduction. Thank you.
Thank you.
So, Valery, you are working on Golos. Golos may be more known as Steemit, right? But Golos is for the Russian street, and it's a version of this. And you took the algorithm from the original project, and because you're representing now the Golos project here, so Please tell us why you think this this consensus algorithm is superior.
Okay, thank you. My colleague little bit described disadvantages of proof of work. I absolutely agree with them because for a lot of reasons. But as we know, history goes around via loops, and I think proof of work will find the newborn will take newborn when algorithms like Cuckoo will take mass adoption, because all people who have mobile phones, IoT devices, can contribute to the network. Back to the delegated proof of stake and proof of stake. The two main points which I choose to delegate proof of stake. The first one, cause we can in each round choose the set of miners and validators in the network. We can set the network block generation time and set it to time which needed to this network. In Steam and goals, it's 3 seconds. It's pretty fast, but guys tested in BitShares that without modernization of code, it's we can we can make 1 second block duration time. If we would like to make block generation time smaller, of course, due to the reason of network latencies, we need the modernization of algorithm and more efficient code base. The second reason why deposit is good, because I think, as you know, in delegate proof of stake, you have delegates which validates block, and in different networks, the number of these delegates witnesses may be different, but this is people, companies, organizations who committed to running node and validate blocks. And after they started their node, people can vote for this node account.
Minute.
Okay, thank you. And this node starting validated block. And this is the huge motivation to the network, to developers, to guys who are bringing value to the network, because if you're bringing value, if you're a developer, you can run node, start your witness node, and you will take a reward from the network. And this is a very good concept. I think this can bring in very fast growth to the networks who are choosing a delegate proof of stake. Thank you.
Okay, just on time. So thank you, Valery. Yeah, I'm just dealing with my timer. Trent, how was your flight?
I still missed that. How was my what?
Flight.
My here. Flight? Ah, yeah, very good. Thank you. Yes.
It's so, quite a long flight, right?
Well, actually, no. I live in Berlin, so not too bad.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. Cool. So you are going to tell us about your project, which is Big Chain DB, quite popular. Okay, thank you.
Yes, thank you. Maybe I'll just start with sort of a way of framing it. You know, we all use the web, and when we use the web, we use services like Facebook and Google and so on, right? You know, Facebook has 2 billion users, and it has it's actually storing information about that. And if I log into my Facebook from anywhere in the world, it will, you know, tell me my account and my friends and so on. Have any of you ever wondered how it kind of manages to do that? Well, under the hood, it's got, you know, not just terabytes, not just petabytes, but exabytes of information. That's, you know, 1 million terabytes, right? About you and other people. And it's actually updating that and syncing that. It's using actually thousands and thousands of machines to store that, right? So each machine stores just a little bit, a shard, which is a term that goes back decades. As more machines are added, as more shards are added, then it has more and more capacity, right? What if one of those shards gets destroyed, right? It crashes, the hard drive crashes, whatever, what then? And that's where you have a copy of it, or two copies, or five copies, right? That's the replication factor. So normally with these distributed systems, you have a replication factor of 2 or 5 or 10, right? So, you know, only if 10 of your hard drives, of those hard drives crash, that has your information, do you lose everything? With Bitcoin, we hear about, say, 6,000 full nodes. That's actually a replication factor of 6,000, right? So it's actually like going really strong overkill in some ways to store all that data. So, you know, Google, Facebook, all these companies that have these supermassive systems serving billions of people, they actually get there via consensus algorithms to keep things in sync, but also via sharding to have more and more things. And they're using under the hood to store all of this distributed databases, right? So these are databases that have been around for decades. They got really good in the late 90s, early 2000s, right? And now there's databases like MongoDB and others, DynamoDB, et cetera, that they're like really production worthy for you know 20 years, right? These are the things that power the web. And you might ask, well, if these exist, why are we even up here talking about consensus, right? And the answer is, these databases are fault tolerant. So hard drive crashes, you know, lightning strikes a data center, kills everything. They can handle that, but what they cannot handle is malicious faults, Byzantine behavior, right? So along comes a sysadmin and deletes everything, right? So if you have, say, 20 nodes and three crash, you're okay. But if one sysadmin goes into one of those nodes, kills everything, that's no good. So you wanna solve that, and algorithms to solve that are Byzantine fault tolerant, right? And then, of course, if you wanna go get extra fancy from fault tolerant to Byzantine fault, you might want to say, hey, what if we also want to allow anyone to join and to run a node, right? And that's called permissionless or Sybil tolerant, et cetera, right? So there's sort of three levels, fault tolerant, Byzantine, and Sybil tolerant. So with BigchainDB, we built it to target a set of problems that we saw. 1 minute, okay. Where it's okay to know identity of the people running the servers, right? And so you can be Byzantine fault tolerant without having to be Sybil tolerant, permissionless. So that's what BigchainDB is. We wrap MongoDB, which is one of the top databases out there. BigchainDB therefore inherits the properties of MongoDB for scale, for querying, and all of that. And then we add Byzantine tolerance on top of that, as well as characteristics that are blockchain, which is the decentralized, which you get from Byzantine. Immutability and assets or tokens. So that's basically what we do with BigchainDB. BigchainDB is not trying to solve the permissionless, the Sybil tolerance. We could get there with something like DPoS to wrap BFT, but we're not trying to solve that right now. Cosmos does that. That's essentially what Stima and the graphene architecture does, et cetera. But we're really focusing on BFT and the applications around that, and there are lots within, especially enterprises and consortia, et cetera. Okay, great.
Okay, cool. Thank you. So, Maxim, you're going to tell us about consensus ideas in Pandora blockchain.
Yeah, correct. I will be probably starting with some ideas behind the protocol and the project, because it will explain why do we need our own consensus of some particular properties. So the basic idea is that we would like to build some uncensorable, so censorship-resistant layer protocol, on top of which you can run parallel computing, generic parallel computing, including artificial intelligence. Why it is important? Maybe all of you heard about the risks that are coming with artificial intelligence progress. The point is that to manage those risks, to mitigate them, one needs to create an open market with a competition and economical incentives. So there wouldn't be any reason for artificial intelligence to fight humans, but to trade with them. And if there is a kill switch on top of AI from the humanity, the first incentives of AI would be to kill humanity, just not to be killed. So we would like to create a censorship-resistant environment which can't regulate the AI in a way it wouldn't be incentivized to do something with the rest of the world. So censorship resistance is the core. And we are looking at consensus algorithm in terms of censorship resistance as a first primary value. And from this point of view, I'm a big fan of proof of work systems, probably the only one on this panel. And what we try to achieve is to create a proof of work for cognitive computing. How we can prove that we are doing a proper work with a cognition. Because cognition is in fact a sort of hashing. You know, probably everybody of you, that some genius in humanity, they provide idea which is really hard to find, but very easy to prove once they found. So it's a sort of hashing function. And starting from that, we built quite a lot of research and development. We found what we call the proof of cognitive work, how to prove that the actual computation in parallel mode was correct without repeating them. And that was the first layer of our consensus, which was based on a variant of proof of work. But additionally to that, we will need some censorship resistance layer. And that layer is based on variation of proof of stake. We call it proof of reputation because it's a bit different to the monetary stake. And this part is developed by Andrew Sobel, who is also here, and there is a number of interesting things there. I wouldn't have a time to describe all of them, so you can just come and discuss in private. So we have a hybrid model of two levels of consensus, proof of work and proof of stake, that works together, we hope, quite well. And we call this protocol and the consensus a Prometheus. It's easy to understand why Prometheus. Yeah. And we focusing not only on development, but also on scientific proofs and investigation of the protocol, quite a lot inspired by the way the RHK does that for the Ouroboros. And I will talk a little bit later when comparing proof of work and proof of stake, some of the results of our research in this respect. Well, practically all.
Okay, sounds cool. So let's do that. Before we open this to the audience, I will ask each of you one question. Probably this is the time we have. Something that interesting, especially for me, right? And trying to give you a chance to give us more details about the project and the ideas. And then we will open it to the public, okay? So let's keep the same order. So Roman, please tell us about Ouroboros, the proof of stake algorithm. Is it delegated proof of stake, or how it's improved from the original delegated proof of stake, or it's completely new and have no connection to delegated proof of stake? And let's keep it 2 to 3 minutes, okay?
Okay, cool. So it's not delegated proof of stake. We use delegation, but it doesn't connect it to depose, which is used in BitShares or something like that. Sometimes it can be confusion, like depose is used for delegated POS. We use depose as dynamics proof of stake. What is the main problem with proof of stake solution that existed before Ouroboros? It was proposed the first solution in Peercoin or NXT or Newcoin or some other. if we look from a mathematical point of view of a proof of work solution, what do miners do? They play some lottery. They have some hashing power, and this hashing power has a pseudo-random nature. And they play the game, and within this game, the winner is selected within lottery among all participants, and the probability, the chance to be selected as a winner, is proportional to the amount of hashing power. the same model was moved to the proof of stake solutions, but what was the problem of the first generation of proof of stake algorithm? The problem was that each participant that created new block, he put his own randomness into the chain. And each participant could manipulate this randomness and to create a chain, create a variant of chain where he has the higher probability to be elected more one more time and to earn more money as a when he behave as a rational participant. So in this case, different participants in Peercoin or somewhere else can create millions of different chains, million of different forks, and the system cannot come to the same decision. Because of this, they had to use some type of centralization, like the checkpoints or something like that. In Ouroboros, we completely solved that problem. We use a special cryptographic transformation, which is called multi-party computation. And for this cryptographic transformation, we guarantee that randomness, which is taken to run the protocol, is truly random and it is honest. Every participant who has the blockchain can verify it. Every participant who runs the protocol can participate in it. And if we have more than one half, if we have the majority of honest participants, we guarantee that the output is truly random, and this lottery run among different participants are also fair. So we get the same properties as for proof of work, but we use cryptographic techniques that allows us not to spend huge amount of energy, that allows us to run a normal proof of stake, but with the same properties that have proof of work systems, traditional proof of work systems.
So I have a question here. So if you're talking about consumption of energy, should I care about this? Like, if everybody pay for their consumption, like why should I care? Just small question.
What is the problem with energy consumption? It's not free. So yeah. You must pay for this energy.
Yes,
And it,
I do.
And it should be paid by participants.
Right.
So it must be
included. They want to.
It must be included whether in the transaction fees or to newly minted coins that is hidden tax to all cryptocurrency holders or something
right.
like that.
Right.
So we just waste resources for nothing for creating these pre-images of hash functions. But we can have and we definitely do have a more efficient solution.
Cool, got you. Okay thank you. Now Valery, let's talk about Golos. Can you please give us about a little bit about params, some information about what's going on in Golos in consensus sense, and maybe some plans for the future? I'm going to move from depots. Any plans? Maybe back to proof of work. Tell us.
Nice question. I would like to describe first of all problems of depots which we found.
Some people say it's perfect.
Time. Sorry?
Some people say it's perfect, like no problems.
Not at all. And after that, about params. You know, the one huge problem with delegated proof of stake, because all users, all accounts, may vote for any other account as a delegate, as a witness. But not all peoples, all accounts, voting. And it's a big problem because Steam and Golos, what is going on in these systems, it's a great example of liquid democracy. But if not all people electing witnesses, voting for witnesses, which represents their opinions, network cannot cannot go to the way which community would like to, and the equilibrium point in the network very hard to achieve, because when peoples don't see the results of their opinions, their votes, don't continue voting or don't start voting for witnesses. And this is problem of chicken and egg, and or as a side of problem of problem or problem of common society in the network. And this can be fixed for we see one of the solutions, the parameterization of the all parameters of the blockchain. Also, it's a splitting
witnesses to the two subsets, to the one group which are validators who should put just a stake, huge stake, to which will allow them to just sign and sign blocks. The other group, it's witnesses, which will only one function of them votes and sets the great parameters of the network, parameters of the blockchain, of the consensus, of the inner economy and social parameters of the inner economy. So, and one very interesting point that reward which network pay to the witnesses, I think should be also parameterized. Because now the reward for witnesses not so big, mm-hmm. but if this reward will be bigger, like salary in top IT company in Silicon Valley or something kind like that, mm-hmm. and this. And community will support this. This will attract a lot of good developers, a lot of motivated people who will bring new value, develop code base, core base of the blockchain.
For the project. Okay.
Okay.
Okay,
you.
Cool. Trent, you are next. So you are running PBFT, algorithm of consensus inside our decentralized world. How do you feel about this? Do you sleep well at night?
So I'm an engineer, and I simply like to solve problems that matter. And sometimes it's okay to have identity, right?
Okay.
So BFT algorithms, you have to know the identity of the servers. But the benefit that you get is throughput, scale, et cetera, right? So that's perfectly fine. Whereas other applications, you do want to have the servers to be permissionless, et cetera. And I'm a big fan of the public nets that do that. So
cool.
It's just the right tool for the job.
Yeah. Okay. and how you choose who actually control the consensus? Like, what nodes? How much nodes you need there? Who are the people that actually responsible for them? Like, are they have to part of your GAND or a company, or you can also do some contracts with subcontractors or something like that? Like, how it works?
Yeah, so with BigchainDB, we focus on it simply as open source software, not as a network. So people can download it and play with it locally, et cetera. And then they can form their own consortia or run it within their enterprise, et cetera, right? And there are benefits simply to running it even in one enterprise. You might think, oh no, you know, that's totally centralized. But because you have some small degree of immutability, you also have the digital signatures, then there are actually benefits above and beyond just a straight up database. And then of course the consortia, they choose themselves, right? You know, if I'm forming a consortia for a supply chain or something else, they choose among themselves and they make their own contracts and deals, just like we have with consortia, you know, prior to the world of blockchain.
Yeah, but do you have like a main net sort of we know from cryptocurrencies, like maybe you plan some ICO for the blockchain DB?
Yeah, so
no, ICO was the joke, right? But
yeah.
do you have like the live network, the one that everybody can join?
Yeah, so for a while we had been moving towards something called IPDB, Interplanetary Database, and with sort of GDPR coming down the pipe and whatnot, there were some specific legal issues that we had been looking to solve, and in the end, it actually ended up being too much liability on the shoulders of the caretakers. So that is an effort that basically the consortium called IPDB decided to wind down. A really cool thing that emerged, though, and we'll be hearing, there will be more announcements on this. The community picked up the slack of where IPDB left off, and there's going to be, other nets that are emerging towards the applications that those people had been building on. So, and I think this is really exciting because you can have, 10 or 20 or 50 nodes run by a consortium, but anyone could use that. It just depends on what permissions you want, right? Read permissions versus write permissions, and so on. And so, overall, you know, saying private versus public, it's really actually shades of gray depending where your permissioning lies, right? So I think that's very exciting. And by kind of framing things that way, it just opens up to a much broader spectrum of applications. And to your question, you know, how many nodes? It's really up to the users, right? You could have 10, you could have 50, you could have 100. Once you get past 100 or 200, then you start to get into bandwidth issues because it's the bandwidth usage is a square of the number of participants with sort of BFT types algorithms typically.
Okay, sounds very, very cool. So, Maxim, I have two questions. Let's start with the proof of reputation. So proof of reputation is very interesting term, very interesting concept that you're trying to introduce. Can you tell us more, like how people gain this reputation? Like, let's drill down into the details because it's really innovative, and how you keep from hacking this so people cannot fake the reputation and introduce something that never exists, please.
Yeah, I will probably speak simultaneously about proof of reputation and proof of cognitive work because it's just two sides of the same coin and they are very much intermixed into a single protocol. The idea is that with a proof of cognitive work, you perform some computations, which are useful computations, and there is economical game set that proves that you have a proper incentivization towards doing the proper computations, not cheating, not having a Byzantine fault behavior, because if you done cheating, you will be found with a higher degree of certainty, it's 99.9%, for instance, and you will be penalized for that with a monetary stake that you put when you run a working node. And when you perform in that way, and you perform a correct, and you participate in some verification and arbitration of the work that is performed by other nodes, you got a reputation. A reputation, it's not a token, it can be seen as a token, but it's not transferable, it's not sellable,
I want to focus you a little bit, like what I get the reputation for, all the node, what it gets the reputation for, what are the...
For what they are getting a reputation,
yeah,
for participating in verification and arbitration of the other cases of cognitive work, because about 10% of all work is verified randomly by other nodes, and this gives a reputation. Mm-hmm. And the second, if there is disagreement about verifier and the actual worker node, who is right, there is an arbitration procedure, a closed arbitration and open arbitration. In open arbitration, any node can participate. Mm-hmm. And for that participation, it's not get paid, it gets reputation instead.
Right.
And with this reputation, he goes to the other level of consensus where he signs the blocks, mm-hmm. if he has some reputation beyond some level. Yeah. So basically, the idea is the same as with a proof of stake, but instead of stake, you got reputation. Right. And reputation is not limited in the system. Its emission is not limited. So if you're doing nothing, just get some reputation and staying there signing blocks, you will get diluted constantly. Mm-hmm. And you still have to do an actual work to get the system running. And it's not the incentives and mining is not proportional to your stake, it's proportional right. to your reputation. Right. But you get a stake for the reputation. So it's yeah. a mixed model with many degrees of freedom, which mm-hmm. gives us the flexibility to develop the system in yeah. ways that we can't think today, probably.
So once you gain the reputation, it's very easy to explain that you are not a hacker and you're actually part of the system and you contribute to this. But how you keep it from be fake? Like, how you know that the reputation was gained for some real work, but not like Sybil attack, but here is Sybil proof of reputation. You actually give nodes, gain nodes that you also control and then give you the reputation, something like that. How you protect this?
The protection is between the layers of the network. You get reputation only for the proved proper work, proved by the network. So it's a part of consensus. You can't steal it somehow. Right. And once you get it, if you've done something like a Byzantine behavior on the other level of consensus, you lost your reputation instantly.
Cool. Okay.
So it's a part of consensus.
So this is
mechanism.
The big penalty, right?
Sorry?
the big penalty you
had. Yes, but it's not monetary penalty anyway.
Right. But reputation gains some value. Right, yeah. I don't understand. Mm-hmm. Okay, cool. We just up the time for you. So guys, this is my questions. We are opening this to audience. For this, we need somebody to control the mic. Do we have somebody, Pavel? Somebody to control the mic for the audience? And somebody who wants to ask questions? Yeah, so please tell your name and who you're asking for. And don't we have more mics? Okay, cool. So before the questions, your name and who, or you asking all the panel. It's also fine.
Okay, my name is Vitaly. I don't know who to ask. I just want to ask for everyone. But okay, let it be Roman maybe. In various types, because I think you're working with big research group, I think for various types of consensus protocols, there are various types of attacks. What will be the main vector of attack? It can be attack on finality, or it can be on liveness, or it can be a kind of cartelization or monopolization. So what is the main vectors in practical side of you for the proof of stake algorithms of next level, I think?
Okay, thank you. Roman.
Very good question. When we developed our model, we took two main properties of blockchain. It's persistence and liveness. Persistence, it means if transaction is put into blockchain after some period of time, very limited period of time, it cannot be taken back, so we don't have double spend attack. And we provide liveness property. It means we prevent censorship. If someone or some group of miners or participant want to prevent some transaction from including into the blockchain, they cannot do it. We also have a very short period of time within which transaction will definitely appear, and according to in blockchain and according to persistent property will remain there forever. So we considered this situation, but it's a mathematical model. That's quite okay. So what I can say about vectors, possible vectors of attack, of course, we live in the real world. If, for example, some government agency like National Security Agency or something like from Russia or China or somewhere else with huge resources will try to make denial of service or to crack software, of course, we cannot guarantee it. It's possible to do it. For example, if Chinese government would like to switch off internet or Russian government will develop hacking tools to crack operating system over which our tools are running. Mm-hmm. Of course, it's possible. Okay. But here we have security model. We also work from game theoretic analysis point of view to prevent even maybe not government level attacks, but right. Attacks of a little bit smaller scale.
Yeah. So okay. So I guess Trent, you want to comment on this also? Please. Vector attacks is a very interesting issue. It's a big issue. So try to keep it very brief. Okay. Thanks.
Right. Yeah. So in the world of databases and consensus more broadly, there's this concept, the CAP theorem, which he was basically implicitly referencing. But what it means is consistency, availability, partitions, tolerance. Pick any two. Right, and the best way to frame that is, if the network splits in two, if it partitions, do you want to be available to take in transactions to write, or do you want to stay consistent? And amazingly, a lot of the early blockchains out there actually choose availability, which is kind of amazing. So like, for example, with Bitcoin, right? Let's say that most of the mining power is in China, right? So let's say that China puts up a firewall with the rest of the internet, and then Bitcoin runs for a month inside China and outside of China, right? And then that firewall goes away and the network rejoins. Guess what? All of the transactions in the rest of the world will disappear because of the longest chain rule, right? So it's a kind of a surprising result of this bias towards of availability, right?
Right. Okay. Okay, cool. Thank you. Any more questions?
We to address them later.
Anybody? Or we can continue to talk. Yeah, you want there? Okay, please, mic to the guy on the left. Your name and who you asking the questions. The question.
My name is Andrei. I want to ask Valery about Golos and delegated proof of stake consensus in Golos and Steam. Nothing on stake attack. Do you have any prevent nothing on stake attack in the boss algorithm? And if we just now doesn't have this prevention, how we can implement it in Golos and Steam?
Okay. The question was about nothing on stake attack, the famous vector. Okay, please.
There is a resistance from the beginning, because in the reason in Steam and Golos they are free transactions, and it's achieved by accounts have initial balances, which with these balances you are statically reserved proportional bandwidth of the whole network. So if you have an account and you can make transactions, that means that you have a balance already on the network. And when you would like to register any account, you have two options. Somebody should register you and give you the initial stake. Or the second option, we also have an integrated proof of work, and you can run your own node in a proof of work mode and mine your account, mine block reward.
I'm sorry. Is it the plan for the future or today? You have part of the idea.
It's from the beginning.
Oh, I didn't know this. Okay, cool.
Yeah, it's a.
So it's like sub proof inside the consensus algorithm. Like
yeah,
sub-proof.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Little bit detail. There are 21 witness. The top 19, which are choose via voting. The end of the group, because number of witnesses can be a huge amount, and one witness in a round choose from the other witnesses, which not in the top 19, and one more choose from equity of miners, and they can be hundreds, thousand miners who are mining coins, and can one in a round sign block.
Okay, sounds good. Thank you. So Pavel said me that me finishing this panel. So guys, you can discuss more about consensus in the lobby with our specialists. So please give them the applause that they deserve. Thank you.